translating it for you. We will have a talk about digital manipulation resiliency. There will be a breakout room later, and the link for that is in the schedule. Lea Richter works with many things, and most of them have to do with the dream world internet and learning processes within children, such things. What's interesting to her in the moment is the digital manipulation resiliency. What it is, she will tell us. She will talk quickly, because a lot of things have to be put in. And yeah, enjoy. Yeah, I'm happy that you're warned in advance. There will be quite a high speed. I hope you can follow anyway. My name is Lea Richter, and as announced earlier, it's going to be about digital manipulation resiliency. So how can we resist manipulation? So the question is, how and why does manipulation work? And why does populistic narratives and propaganda work? Why do people believe that? Why do people believe in conspiracy myths? And yeah, to answer that, we have to check, why are we susceptible to manipulation? And I say we, because a typical idea that is that many people have is, yeah, other people are manipulated. It's those idiots over there. It would never happen to me. Which is a nice feeling, because then you don't have to work on it. But of course, all of us can fall for manipulation. So all of us should know how it works and how to protect ourselves. So, how are we affected by this? There are three main points that I find interesting or important. All of us have psychological needs that can be used and abused. We all have phases in our lives where we are more susceptible. And vulnerable phases. And all of us have a brain that can be tricked systematically. So, what are our basic needs? Well, maybe Maslow's pyramid. No, it's more psychological basic needs. And there are several concepts about this. Most people agree on the first three, and others add the other two, and I find them important as well. So I want to show all five to you. First is tie or bonding, or bonds, and not only to your parents, but also belonging to a social group that's relevant. We have a wish to belong. And we see this also as protection, to belong. The next is control and orientation. So that also is connected to feeling safe. We want to feel safe. If we know our area, our surroundings, then we are able to have control. At least we have the feeling to be able to do so. And yeah, the feeling of control also creates a feeling of safety. The next one is the idea of self-worth. That's very important when we are talking about problems. All of us had the feeling that we are not good enough. And that's unpleasant, because we want to have a good self-image and want to be seen as good from the outside. So that's what we are talking about when we're talking about self-worth. The next is delight or desire, creating it and avoid unpleasant situations. We will see this in the examples more closely later. And then, last but not least, we have meaning. We want a life with meaning and purpose. And when that doesn't work, then someone can come and say, well, come to us. Then we give you purpose. You will have purpose with us. And with this, and meaning, of course, is connected to self-worth. Because if I think my life has a meaning, then that protects my self-worth. I will come back to these all the time. You don't have to memorize them. But this is a very common. So, vulnerable phases. All of us have them. When we really want, long for connection, especially puberty, that's the most common one, when you have the questions, who am I okay as I am, what's my role, can I do what I really want to do in my life, what do I want to become, and especially with the young people who are affected by puberty, already by their age, they're more likely to be naive, because they have fewer life lessons to look back on and fewer experiences. Then there are life crises that can lead to these vulnerable phases, losing your job. When you don't have enough money, you might be overwhelmed. And yeah, whenever we talk about why do people enter conspiracy theories or bubbles, then we are talking about broken lives. And then people were lost or were feeling lost, and there they found connections. Last but not least, we have the topic of having a brain that can be systematically deceived. All of us, most of us, think we are objective and quite rational, but we are not really. We have cognitive biases and other bugs in our minds. And of course, we are bombarded with sensorial input. And all of it wants attention, but we don't have enough attention for all of them. So it gets filtered a lot, also to protect our feeling of self-worth. And it works. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. But it doesn't work 100%. So there are bugs. I brought a few examples of this, and maybe you find yourself in one or two of them. Most of them are quite common shortcuts that we use. A very famous one is the so-called halo effect, when we handle with other, we have contact with other people, so we know one thing about them, that, for example, they are very cleanly, or they have glasses, and with that associated is intelligence. There is no connection, but we remember this from somewhere, or if someone is attractive, a beautiful person, then we will just assume that they are friendly and trustworthy, which obviously doesn't have to be true. That's the halo effect. Then also relevant for us today is the sympathy through similarity. If we assume that someone is similar to us, no matter how we assess this, we assume that they are more sympathetic to us or nicer. And for groups, of course, important is the in-group bias. So when we split a group into subgroups, a school class, for example, we split it into group A and group B, then of course, then immediately group A starts thinking group A is better, just because they were split into groups. We don't have any explanation yet, just the splitting into groups will cause this effect to happen. Another interesting point for manipulation attempts is commitment and consistency. So, if I bring you to agree with something simple, and afterwards I ask you something a bit more challenging, but going in a similar direction, then you will be more likely to agree again, because you want to be consistent. because you showed a little commitment and you want to stay consistent. Who said A also has to say B. Reactance is something more like defiance. If you saw an ad that you didn't like and it made you defiant. And that's also called reactance. If we have a feeling that someone wants to limit us in some way, then we become defiant and want to work against it. That also works together with scarcity. If someone says, yeah, this is limited edition or it's only available for 2 days, then there is scarcity, usually artificial scarcity. And if I have a feeling someone wants to keep me from something, then I want it more. Another trick in advertisement. And reciprocity. If I make a gift to you, then you will have a slight need to also give me a gift. And if I want to manipulate you, I can use that. That's why you get gifts from advertisers. Many of these are not only connected with interacting with other people, but also with learning about the world. There's the negativity bias, of course. We tend to overestimate negative input and potential warnings about dangers. So danger is a very important keyword here, because it's possible that being afraid is important. But it also means that when we have a 50-50 day, 50% good, 50% bad, that we focus more on the negative stuff. And we then think, well, it was a bad day. When talking about communication, it also means that negative topics will capture our focus more. The confirmation bias means that when we already have an opinion, then we are more likely to see information that confirm our bias or our already formed opinion. Because we want to avoid unpleasant situations, and of course it's an energy-saving mechanism as well. If you always question yourself, it costs energy, of course. It's a shortcut that can work quite well. And then the proportionality bias. So if something dramatic happens, we accept a reason for this that's equally dramatic. There is this idea that the corona pandemic cannot just have happened due to little accidents, but it must have been something big that caused it. And confirmation and the proportionality bias are really connected to conspiracy myths. And when you think that's enough, well, we are still not done. Because not only our thinking is warped, but also the thinking about the thinking. Because all the things that I showed you, it's quite likely that you think, yeah, well, okay, it affects other people, but it doesn't hit me, right? Because we believe that we are not affected by these effects, which leads to us being less conscious about these effects. And also manipulation in the internet. We know these things happen. But we think, and now that's the third person effect, that's about the others. I'm not affected. And yeah, it's unpleasant, I know, but it affects all of us. So what does that mean? These points make us all vulnerable to manipulation. We have basic needs, and they make us vulnerable. So we want pleasure, we desire pleasure, we want connection, and we have phases of heightened vulnerability, puberty or crises, like losing our job, and our brain wants to save energy, and so it can be a poor judge. Wie könnte das jetzt aussehen? Wir haben jetzt gesehen, what can this look like in reality? So we have the basic vulnerabilities.
Deshalb habe ich mal ein paar Beispiele mitgebracht, wie das sein könnte, wie das aussehen könnte, wenn jemand versucht, das zu akzessieren.
We have some examples here.
Ich versuche jetzt euer Vertrauen zu gewinnen und euch zu
irgendeinem. Let's assume that I'm trying to manipulate you, I'm trying to gain your trust. Maybe I'm trying to make you buy something. We have some examples here. It could be like the following.
Um den Ton schon mal zu setzen, könnte ich sagen, gut.
To set the tone.
Und mach mich besonders hübsch, ja?
I would make myself look really pretty.
Und euer Auftreten zu imitieren.
I could try to imitate what you're doing. I'm talking about here the halo effect. And then if I'm pretty, then you can assume that I'm also intelligent and friendly. And I'll try to gain your sympathy. And I'll do things similar to how you're doing, and then also be open.
Im nächsten Schritt bitte ich vielleicht um
at the next step, and then I will increase the intensity over time. For fundraising, I could say, hey, do you have a heart for animals? No one says, oh, I hate animals, they're awful. So once you say yes to this, I have a heart for animals, then you have your commitment, and then you want to be consistent later, and then also say yes, and then you can increase the intensity. Once you have the first commitment, then it's uncomfortable to say no later. Maybe I'll give you a gift, maybe a pen. This is reciprocity. So once you give someone, then in 20 minutes later, I will ask you if you want to buy a product. What else could I do? I could promise for a community that I'll be by your side in this community. So this is talking about a connection for a group, also for your self-esteem. And this is an exclusive community that we're talking about. I can also promise you a role that's important to you, that also speaks to your self-esteem. What's important is also to explain. It's not like everyone has the same reaction. You don't knock on a door and get the same thing every time. But you're trying to increase the probability. And when you go somewhere and you combine all these tricks together, then you increase the probability. What's relevant for us today? That under all this you feel stress, and this is the key to everything. You can notice the stress, and you can notice that maybe you are being manipulated with these. And these tricks only work when the victim doesn't recognize that they're being manipulated. And yet, right now the question is, how does this work actually? What are exploits that we're talking about? What are the patterns? We have four phenomena, just all in the last years. Populism, propaganda, radicalization, and conspiracy theories. I brought this explanation for a spectrum of populism. How you can separate these two things could be another presentation. But we're talking about extremism here. And we're not just talking about on the internet here.
Wer das Narrativ nicht kennt, grob gesehen bedeutet dieses Narrativ im großen Austausch, dass große Gruppen von Geflüchteten nach Deutschland geholt werden oder...
So there is the story of the Great Replacement, and the core idea is that foreigners are brought into the country to replace the population. Of course, they suggest an aggressiveness. And dangerous about this is that it legitimizes violence, and a lot of bad things have happened because of it. So, what are the cores of this? So, the first sentence. Fleeing people are different from us. They are dangerous warriors. So, mostly they are talking about the men only, and we are working on establishing an in-group. We, that's the Germans, the good ones, and the bad ones, that's the warriors, that's the foreigners. And with a good in-group, the self-worth of the audience is heightened, and then we also have the negativity bias. So, it's a possible danger, so it's already more important to us. And then the army is a framing, is an artificial frame already. Those are people fleeing, they are not an army. But if you see them as single people, you might have sympathy. But if you see them as warriors, as an army, you don't have sympathy. You have to fight them. So they try to make a certain reaction more likely and another one less likely. Then they are talking about waves, a stream, and that's a danger for single people. Again, it's not a person that's coming, but an amorphous mass. And again, this is no accident. It's manipulating language. And again, a victim and criminal exchange. We're saying they are threatening us. And of course that would legitimize violence. And we're saying, yeah, they're coming here. And right now we are still able to act. And it would legitimize a preventative strike. And whenever you hear that someone threw a Molotov cocktail into a home of those people, and when they are asked, why did you do that? Well, I'm just defending the motherland. And that's based on these images. And if you target enough people with these narratives, then it's just a statistical issue that some and usually enough will react just as you want them to. Then usually this idea with the Great Replacement is also connected with the idea that the government is in on it. And now I'm wondering, what does the government do? Is it protecting me? And the media, are they protecting me? Are they open? And now they say, no. They are in on it. You can't talk to them. They're in on it. You can talk to us. And so people are brought into the conspiracy bubbles. And in the end, there's the sentence, we are the only ones doing anything about this danger. We are the heroes. And the whole hero's journey, we are the downtrodden, the suppressed, and we become the heroes of the story. It's a nice story. But at the end of the day, the people sending these messages want to gather resources, be it money, be it new members. So what were they doing? They had a dramatic scenario of danger. They created fears. They lessened trust into functioning structures. And they were presenting themselves as the only solution against the fears. And of course they want to use that to gather and secure power. And that also answers, who profits of this? Well, the populists themselves. Let's come back to propaganda. In the last weeks, sadly, it's very visible again. So there is Russian propaganda. And how they were justifying their attack on Ukraine. And there's some of the core ideas. Before they actually attacked, they were saying, well, that's fake news. We are not collecting our troops near the border. So Russia is saying, we as in-group, we are attacked in the media. The West media, they make false claims about us. And here, of course, the Western powers are not trustworthy, but we are because we know how it really is. Then it was said that Ukraine attacks Russians in Donbass, and we need to help. So they are our brothers and sisters. They are part of our in-group. They are attacked. We need to become heroes and help them. So a self-heroization, and it's easier to justify to help others than to attack them. And there is a dangerous scenario again, so a negativity bias also ensures that we are attracted to this and will focus on it, and our safety, our want for safety is affected. And then the next, we are framing the borders away because they say the Ukraine has been part of Russia for all times. And then the next one, they are talking about ethnicification of the Ukraine because we are talking to the in-group with something which they all know, which they carry in themselves. In this story, there's the Nazis and there's us. It's obvious who's the good guy and who's the bad guy. And now we use this image of the good guys and the Nazis, and we apply it to this situation. And if they are the Nazis, then they are the ultimate evil. There's no more evil than Nazis. And we then obviously have to be the good guys, and that also protects you against criticism, because whoever is against me is on the side of the Nazis within this frame. And that's quite obviously why it's used. So what happened here? Well, they're using pretty much every narrative that makes Russia appear innocent or as a hero, not aggressive. Then they are using old images like the that creates a group think, like the fight against the Nazis, and all other messages are named as propaganda. Then the offers of radicalization. I brought two of them. Why am I saying offers? Well, there is different ways to radicalize yourself. Of course, people can have certain wishes within themselves already and radicalize themselves. Of course, that is happening. What I want to show is when radical groups, they start communication to bait in vulnerable people, and that's why I called it an offer. So we have this example of Islamistic recruiters that's still happening. So for example, we have direct messages in social networks, and what they like to do is address teenagers. Both of the, our examples now are addressing teenagers. So extremists like to address teenagers who have an Islamic background or are seen as such. So people of color, basically. So let's start at the beginning. We're talking about teenagers, so we have a vulnerable phase. And we start slowly. Just get the door in the step. Make them like you. Maybe pay a compliment. And so increase their self-worth. And you signal them, well, we are in the same group. We are the same in-group. We are brothers, right? And then, right, then immediately they starting with the discrimination experiences. So they will never accept you. The Western people will never accept you. And then again, the in-group and out-group are strengthened. You are one of us, but they will not accept you. They hurt you before, they will hurt you again. And then the question remains, well, if they don't accept me, who can I belong to? And then there's the offer. You, who has been rejected so much, if you join us, you are part of the big community of Muslims. You're part of the group. You will get a task with meaning. You will serve God. And then old images of the hell and the great antagonist, the devil, are brought up again. And yeah, if you are against it, you go to hell. But if you help us, if you're with us, you'll be cleansed of all sin and all will be good. So we are working, here we are seeing a lot of work with fear and also the promise that the fear will go away. And of course, negativity bias and the need for security are here as well. Then of course, there will be, there is added structure of everyday life. When you as a person are asking yourself, where's my place in the world and what can I do? And they give you a structure because it may be work, but it's worth it because it gives you meaning and a structure. And then of course, all external information is reclassified as untrustworthy and people are isolated. So what happened here? Vulnerable teenagers were addressed. Discrimination that happened in the past is used. So their negative experiences are used. And solutions, easy solutions are offered. And they are isolated against contrary beliefs. And of course, there's indoctrination using rituals and media and social connections. So they get sucked into the rabbit hole deeper and deeper. Now, far-right extremism. And the funny thing is, these two groups who are enemies, extremely enemies, they work together almost. So the stronger extremist groups on both sides become, they make it easier for the other side to recruit as well. Once the Nazis get, or the far-right extremists get stronger, discrimination rises, and this rising discrimination makes it easier for Islamist groups to recruit. And it's a vicious circle. So ideologically, they are enemies, but they work almost hand in hand. And very interesting, something that I want to show here, have just center cultural recruitment, like using memes, that's done by both groups as well. So what do we have? We have pop culture offers on social media. Again, we are in the vulnerable phase, teenagers. And the first, of course, we are saying that being German has value. You might feel not nice enough, not beautiful enough, whatever, but as soon as you're part of the group, you're worth something. Then the good old time is mentioned. And enhanced. And of course, the enemy, be it the Jews or just the enemy is downgraded. And again, the beginning is low-key. So, for example, patriotism. That's might not be something you like, but in conservative circles, that's a very positive thing. But it might also be love for nature. We can see on Instagram how people like it. And of course other thing, vaporware, music, memes, YouTube, there are right-wing influences as well. But yeah, they want to show, I'm one of you. And all of this also is fun, in a way. And the dangerous thing about this is that it's low-key, but already the content is, again, is radical. It's not not too obvious, but it's already misanthropist. And of course, whenever they are criticized, they say, no, it's just irony. And whenever someone attacks this within this frame, that's just someone who doesn't know fun and who's too serious. And of course, we're talking about teenagers. And teenagers really like destroying borders and crossing borders. Because people like to say, well, yeah, I can handle fun and jokes. But of course, there is irony poisoning. And that teaches that the more I watch these jokes and memes, the more serious it becomes. Lastly, we have a pulling into the rabbit hole again, and it's framed as being quite elitist or elite. And so they are pushing the feeling of self-worth again, more and more, and of course social connection again. So all these mechanisms are there again. So what happened here? Mostly pop cultural interests were used to target teenagers, and they are using those channels to put right-wing ideas everywhere and extremist ideas everywhere, masked as irony and jokes. And they are recruiting more and more people, and those people also bring money and more influence. Let's come to the last point in this phenomenon.
This is something that's grown over the last 2 years as a theme, and especially regarding Corona, we're seeing viral content through YouTube videos, through comments, through screenshots, and these are collective and very strong viral content. What was done here? So this is the model, it's happened in reality as well. We know that they're trying to gain our sympathy, we want them to like them. We're separating the big evil people over us and the small good people that are us, that are under them. We're also talking about anti-Semitism here, unfortunately. We're saying it's the other bad people, the other group that are against us. And there's activated anti-Semitism. We have proportionality bias as an example here. It's a tendency that's once there's a result of something that has a dramatic result, there's a lot of anxiety there. So it might be a coincidence, but there's an explanation of this big bad thing. There's a scenario where something happens as a coincidence. We hope that something happened doesn't actually happen. We're looking for something that we can actually do, so that there's an influence. We can have an influence on the result of something. We're talking about media here, and also of the yellow press. Sometimes there's people lying, there's confirmation bias, people are saying do your own research. People also have their own ideological bubble here.
So, don't take my word for it. Saying goes, Google it. And of course, we know that there are so many sources out there that repeat my picture, that reproduce my picture, that something will be found. So there is this confirmation bias. Another nice thing is a simulated majority, giving the impression that we are many or we are the people. We know this. This is how it works when right extremist people fill comment columns trying to make it appear as if they have the majority opinion. We're not free from being influenced by a perceived majority opinion, so that it's being used. And of course, then the imagery of being suppressed and having to resist comes in. These people want to kill us with the vaccinations. You remember the incident at the petrol station in Germany where someone was shot having asked a customer to wear their mask. So this is what happens when these statements keep being repeated and under the guise of we are the people and we are fighting against it. And at the end of the chain, we have people that are invited to join more radicalized opinions, where they are constantly being bombarded with these messages. If you've seen these Telegram groups, you know what I mean. And of course, you don't tend to be in just one of these groups either. I couldn't resist that, I suppose. It's very hard. And so what you have is someone trying to declare that they know the truth in a way that generates a certain effect. You divide into a clear good and evil scenario, and you use scapegoat images, and you discredit serious sources, and share other media that you want the people to look at. You spread fear, and of course you offer a solution as well. We are the heroes. We will fight against the state of fear that you've planted in, that has been implanted into your brain. And it's very hard to then work against this under this constant bombardment. And that's how you get drawn in. So what are the common features that you see? What always happened was the fear scenarios and the attempt to sell a certain offering as the solution. You link to established concepts. And I am offering redemption. I can promise you we can put things right, which is, of course, very perfidious, but it works. You link to established concepts. You don't have to do the whole work of coming up with these narratives yourself. You use framing to reinterpret reality and immunize against criticism, and you activate and serve certain psychological basic needs. And you isolate the audience from other sources of influence, making it more easy to influence them. yourself. Okay, take a breath. We have looked at ways, vulnerabilities that are inside you that can be used by others to connect to you. How is this used or can be used, and how is it being used in various scenarios that we keep finding on the internet? And since we talk about digital manipulation, it does play a role on which playing field this whole game is being played. The whole internet and social media field is different here. Of course, it's not the case that there was no manipulation before the internet and no manipulative language. Propaganda, of course, did exist, has existed for a long time via state media. Just think back to the 1930s or think of the genocide in Rwanda. In the early 90s, right-wing extremists used mailboxes to communicate. They were always quite good in using current technology to kind of come out from the small group that they were and reach out. And of course, conspiracy myths existed before Telegram as well. But today's internet makes it much easier for the perpetrators to reach a large target group. Earlier, you would have a lot of effort using radio, TV, print media, perhaps. There always were gatekeepers, and they still exist. You have to reach editorial standards. You have to have sources and all that. So the probability of getting into quality media and reach these target audiences is very low. And these days, that is no longer necessary. Everyone can broadcast, and broadcasting takes place on all channels constantly, which leads to a problem of reaching attention because there are so many channels. But in theory, everyone can have a large reach. In practice, of course, it depends on certain factors. But if I am able to communicate in a way that is matched to the ideological setup of certain groups, then in theory, everyone can find an audience, also because of the lack of gatekeeping. Also, find people that agree with you is, of course, something that is great, but it can be a threat as well, because those that are particularly radicalized or particularly dangerous, that would be one person in one village, perhaps. They found it hard to spread, and these people would always know that they were a small minority, because that was the fact. What's changed now is that these people can use the internet to find like-minded people from the other village and so on, and connect to these and attain an effect that way. And that is what we can see in Telegram, for example, and that is the frightening aspect of it, the negative one. Last but not least, our use of the net isn't that great either. We consume news largely through social media, not always the best kind of sources. And if things are then published there and commented there that serve the way that social media works, which rewards effect. If I don't use these patterns, people will move on to the next topic. So this dynamic doesn't necessarily lead to the information being of high quality. And we know about manipulation, but of course, we assume ourselves to be less easy to be influenced than others. And of course, all the extreme niches of society are reachable through a few clicks, and it's quite easy to get bored and to become curious for something else. And as we leave to be harder to be influenced, this is where we end up. So the conclusion here is, the network is a playground for manipulative communication. And I can use this as a resource without a lot of financial input to reach a large amount of people. looking at this, you have a list of channels on Telegram that you can look at. Here, you can see the frequency of the messages. You have a constant bombardment of messages in these channels, and that all gets to the messenger, to the device in my pocket. And here we have claims that the bloodbath of Bucha was committed by Ukraine. This is from Facebook. And a very, very nice example of a channel view from Telegram where someone asks, why are you allowing governments to murder you? How many subscribers do you have? 160,000 or so. And that is not an outlier. And you have an influencer on the right who cheers about the fact that in Germany the obligatory vaccination was not passed in parliament. So he's saying how he are happy, this person is saying how happy they are and asking for money at the same time.
Okay, we were talking about problems a lot now. And I don't want to end on a negative note, because there is not a huge list of things for you to do. But of course, there are other things. There are things you can do. So it's, we don't like the feeling of saying, well, I have weaknesses, but we are human, we do have. And just wishing it away does not help anything. So we have to face the fact that humans have vulnerabilities and they are beyond our control. And we can go for a walk and try to run away from everyone who tries to talk to us and run away from every fundraiser, but it won't work in the long run. And it's good to know that what affects me, what am I vulnerable to, and what can other people do in a, when talking to me, and really focus on these things. So, what happens if someone addresses us and we notice, well, they are using these tricks? Then you can ask yourself, is it realistic what they promise? Are they promising paradise? Might be unrealistic. Might they promise that all my personal wishes might become real? Slightly too good to be true. What do they want me to do? And what would it lead to if I did it? Always think ahead. And who profits? Am I profiting from this, like it's promised, but maybe the people talking to me right now? Do I recognize a pattern? We've seen it again and again. Create fear and then offer a solution. Can I see this pattern again? Also, should make you skeptical. Also important, how do they react if I disagree or if I say I want to think about it? So I take a step back, maybe I Google. Do they allow it or do they try to keep me in this social moment where they can influence me? Because the moment it stops, I might become more rational and they know, well, they are gone. And those questions might help. And what I really find important, whoever is informed and looks closer, you will still find yourself in these situations, but you will stay able to react properly. Maybe you are interested and you want to see where it leads, but you shouldn't do so blindly. So if you join them because you want, you should stay able to act and to react. So now I talked a lot and quickly, I hope you could still follow. So now a too long didn't read. This is what you should know about manipulative communication. First, we have psychological vulnerabilities that make us vulnerable. Populism, propaganda, and conspiracy myths try to use these vulnerabilities. So baited people are in trouble because of this, and so is the society. as a whole, and internet makes this more dangerous, but who knows these patterns and can recognize them can protect themselves and others. And that's it from me for now. I already see the herald. Yeah, stay safe. Don't let others punk you. Now I have to take a sip. Yeah, thank you very much for this run. For the speed run. Am I muted? No? Okay, all good. So thank you very much for the speed run. It was very informative. Very fast. Yeah, sorry. And there's a lot of questions. So I'll begin. Oh no. Yeah, I'll just begin. How do people begin seeing themselves? Okay, how do people belonging living in the West themselves start making themselves to the outgroup, the evil West, evil NATO? So how can you explain that? Well, I would say the in-group and the out-group can differ a lot. I can make myself to a small in-group, like a local patriotism group. And just because I live in the West and have such an identity, I don't have to like the NATO or define myself by this in-group. I might also say I live here, but I don't like it. Depending on how I see or judge this concept, and also how I want others to react to me, and I see others reacting to me, I might want to define myself differently. Who are the masterminds? So, for example, who's profiting from the image of migration waves? That sounds like personal profit, but I think personally, we have the power layers of parties like the AfD, a German right-wing party, who gain personnel, who gain success, who gain votes and funding, and they can act because of this. It might also be ideology. In my Germany, the right-wing is in power, and the right-wing extremists are in power, and that might be it, but maybe it's just personal financial gain. How can we handle people who we assume are manipulated? Well, the question is, what is manipulated? Someone who is indoctrinated in a certain direction? So, I think I'll answer that. So, with these conspiracy bubbles in the recent years, I hear more and more that, yeah, I can't talk to my family members anymore. They are so deep in the bubble. And yeah, I would say get professional help, because this might be a heavy topic, but I think it's more realistic to reach them if you have a personal connection to them. Karina Nukum and Pierre Lombardi, yeah. I didn't get the second name, sorry. They have wrote a book about this, and they wrote it well for also lay people. But yeah, get help. And you have to know, this is a difficult problem, and it's not on my shoulders alone to get them back, but it's a big task. You can try, but please respect your own limits. And yeah, small addendum to the question, an example. I don't want to get vaccinated because I read on Facebook that it's dangerous. How do I get that person to think? Well, you could start with the sources. Well, where did you read it? Who posted that? Who did they get it? Quite often. Usually it's maybe just a meme. They saw a meme and nothing more. And sometimes there's an article or a video, and then you have to check the sources. And then you have to check, where does it come from? Has it been debunked already? So There are a lot of research and articles already debunking such claims. And of course, what does it mean to you? Why is it relevant to you? Are you maybe fearful in general? Don't you want it dictated from above? What's your issue with it? Do you think that those recruiters that you mentioned are using the methods that you showed because they know about them, or just intuitive, on an intuitive level? Well, the ISIS or the IS, they have manuals for the recruiters, how to address people, what kind of timetable to build for them, what links to send to them. So I would say it's systematic. You mentioned puberty before. Is there something like a digital puberty, this naivety and instability that's disconnected from biological age, but just how you handle the medium? So adults degrade back. I think we would need an expert for this. I don't think I'm qualified. Okay, the advertisers you mentioned. If it's for free, you are the product. Well, yeah, in a way. Others use standards that we can't transcend yet. Is it a standard just like it affects you, the mechanism works? Well, everything is free. Everything is free. Facebook and whatever. And they profit in a way that a single person cannot transcend and might not even want to, because they don't understand how it works and how to gain money with metadata. They can't imagine, because they might build walls for a job, for a living. And that's something you can see, and they get money for that. And invisible works, they are less approachable to people. Yeah, I also think, how much energy am I investing? And if we check our own everyday life, and I would say right here, we are in a techie group, and I bring another topic and say, this is very important. And this one aspect in your life where you think you do it right, and I now show you how everything you do is bad and you have to change a lot. How invested are you in this? And we have so many things in our head, everyday life, and we want to conserve energy. And then it's easy to say, well, it's not that bad. Those experts, what they want, I never had a problem with WhatsApp. It's okay. We'll be fine. And that's, of course, protecting yourself, because we have to conserve our energy. And yeah, so we always have the same problems. Okay, do these beings only fall back into old habits? Only look at faults in other people? Do they just need simple answers? Well, these disturbed beings, that's the problem. These mechanisms work with for all of us, work on all of us. And the asker might already accept that. But yeah, all of us are susceptible to these mechanisms. That's not necessarily a bad person. You can still decide to abuse those mechanisms and increase racism, for example. And that's a conscious decision, but just be affected. Unfortunately, we all have that. And then, of course, it's important What else is important? What are my morals? How do they interact and produce different outcomes? Okay, in this context, a question for the community. Why do we think that our conspiracy ideas, like surveillance capitalism, are better than others? How can we distinguish them? Or how can we place that in your view? Well, that's a sensible question. It proves that we see similar patterns between that we don't accept and those bottles, and then ask, is what we do so different? And we should be open and ask, is it different? And hopefully we say, well, yeah, are we based on facts that are properly researched? And can it be falsified? And do we have the option to say, well, we were wrong? But that moment where you try to figure out what is happening and not just look for evidence for what you already think, then you're on the right way, I would say. And if we are really certain in what we say, then we should be open to have it proven or tested. Next question is in a similar direction. Do these beings have their own morals or their own opinion? And the question already says, well, probably not. Yeah, I would say they do. But the question is again, and that's why psychology might be annoying. We don't have 100 people and they're all the same. They have tendencies, but they all have their own experiences and personality. And the group of beings, there are those and others. Just because someone is influenced by those vulnerabilities, it doesn't mean that they have no personality. It doesn't work like that. Or no morals. All of us are influenceable, and the question is, what else is there? Have I learned to be critical when presented with something? Have I learned that I share my resources? Or have I learned that it's enough if I focus on myself? So different things come together. Do you use platforms in the Fediverse? Mastodon or others? No, not yet. Okay. I would think we are through. Time slot is ending soon. We will soon open our... Yeah, we will now open the breakout room. The link is in the schedule. Sorry, I'm a bit out of sorts right now. We have time for two or three more things. Is it digital or analog manipulation resilience that we're talking about? Well, I want to talk about the digital phenomena mostly today. Because if you are being pedantic, you can say it's a general one. Because the psychology behind it doesn't care if it's analog or digitally. It's the same. I called it digital manipulation resilience because my playing field is the digital space. And the digital discourse between about politics and society. And I see systemic dangers that is not seen properly yet. I don't think I have a problem with you guys here, but in society I think it's underrated. People think, yeah, I closed the laptop and the problem is gone. Unfortunately not. I'll quote, Facebook should be called anti-social media, right? Yeah, I know that. You can. I understand it. And the thesis is well-based, well-founded. There are enough arguments. Well, actually, there is nothing antisocial within human interaction, because as soon as there is interaction, it's social. The outcome might not always be nice, but, well, we could also go further and ask where does the name come from, where does the word come from, and soon we enter Twitter debate territory. Well, it goes in a direction that Mastodon or the Fediverse might be better, but the basis is that you think in good or bad, or good and evil. Isn't that in itself going on your knees just to be on eye level and fighting something that is not fightable because it's not possible to fight it? So what do you mean with who you want to fight? Well, the person who has a different opinion. Well, just because something has a different opinion, I don't have to fight them. It's difficult if you try to sell something as an opinion that is dangerous, like like incitement of people. But then we are in a criminal area, and that's a different thing. There are laws for that. But if we have platforms that have that could just change some systemic policies, I would like that. And maybe in the breakout room someone could talk a bit more about Mastodon, because I don't know it yet. But of course, so if they say, yeah, well, it's just another platform, but yeah, of course, in my platform I can just have different rules. I can have rules that make it more or less likely that someone burns the house down. And if we now have a platform where the rules are better, I think that would be an improvement. Yeah, the basic argument, I think, is that in the Fediverse there are no automatic suggestions following some obscure algorithms. Yeah, that's a good thing, of course. But the platforms use the algorithms to keep us on the platform, to play ads and to get money. And now the question is, are platforms who don't do that able to self-sustain? Maybe donation-based? Does it work? So how much does it cost to remove the attention-keeping algorithm? If that falls away, how much does it cost? Yeah, that's nice. I think that's a good ending point.